Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How were you welcomed when into a new community of faith when you first became a Christian? How were you welcomed? Especially when you, if you came from outside the Christian community. Was it hard or was it easy to integrate into a community of faith? One said yes. when I came to a community of faith, this community of faith, I was sent actually from St. Helens in the city, where I started going to church. And when the time came for me to belong to a church, they sent me to Ilford Baptist Church. And then my integration was quite good. It can be quite messy, you know, when you come into a new community, you can be, obviously you will be, or you are a stranger to them, and then everybody is stranger to you. And it can be quite difficult to be welcomed and to integrate into the community of faith. But in my case, it was good. I was welcomed, I was discipled and baptized, even supported financially to go to a Bible college. And I was given an environment, a perfect environment to grow as a believer. And I had the privilege to be the deacon and then obviously to preach the word. And my experience of integration into the community of faith was very similar of that of Ruth. She, even though she was from a background that which was shameful, which didn't sit comfortably with Israel, because she was from Moabite background, a race that born out of incest, Lord's children. And secondly, when the Israel community were in wilderness, the Moabite women actually seduced the Israel men into immoral relationship and idolatry. So even though she was from a difficult background, still she was welcomed into the community of faith very graciously. Integration is not an easy thing. The both parties need to do their own responsibility, they need to play their own roles. And we can see in this chapter how the both parties play their own roles in integration. So the title of this message is Paraclesis for Paraclesis. As we know that paraclesis means to someone who comes alongside the other to help and to bless and encourage. And in the last chapter, we saw, in the first chapter, we saw that Ruth came alongside Naomi to help, to be there for us, to encourage her. But in this chapter, second chapter of Ruth, which my sister and Missy read to us, Boaz came alongside Ruth. Paraclesis for Paraclesis. I'm going to speak about two things this morning. And the first one is the characteristics of a paraclesis. And the second one is the effect of the characteristics of paraclesis. So the first point is the characteristics of a paraclesis. I'm going to focus on two characteristics, love and kindness. The first is Ruth's love for Naomi. As we know from the last chapter, which Pastor taught to us, that Ruth made a glorious commitment to Naomi, commitment of her love. Just like to remind you, read that glorious commitment, how she actually did it in chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. It says that, but Ruth answered, "Don't ask me to leave you. Let me go with you. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. And your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and that is where I will be buried." This is a glorious commitment of love. You can't find these sort of commitments in the Bible often. But she made this commitment to Naomi. And in another version of the Bible, we read that Ruth clung to Naomi and made this commitment. The body language actually tells you a lot about the seriousness of her commitment. Her commitment was total, it was irrevocable, lifelong, faithful, and unconditional. And the Bible tells us that the real love is more powerful than death. It can accomplish great things, as God accomplished salvation for the world through the Lord Jesus Christ. We see the power of love is stronger than death when the Lord Jesus Christ rose from the dead. And love is not just talk. It's seen in action. As this very famous word verse we read often, God loved the world so much. And what did he do? He gave his one and only begotten son. So love is seen in action. And now it's time for Ruth to show her commitment of love to Naomi. And as you know, you read in, or you learned in the last chapter, that she lost everything and everyone. She's now an old, sad and poor widow, and in need of food and family. So how did Ruth show her love to Naomi? By humbling herself. By humbling herself. How? To choose to do a menial task, very hard work. This is how she did it. In verse 2, it says, "One day Ruth said to Naomi, 'Let me go to the field to gather the corn that the harvest workers leave. I am sure to find someone who will let me work with him.'" You see, Ruth, rather than twiddling her thumb or tapping her toes, or expecting somebody else to provide her needs, she responsibly made a decision to do something about the lack of food. She chose to do gleaning. And in those days, when farmers, they were the three on the hierarchy of the workers. You have the landowner, you have the harvesters, and then you are the workers who go behind the harvesters and tie up the sheaves. And then you have the servants, the people who come and glean, like Ruth here is doing. You just come and glean whatever is left by them, the harvester and the servants. And this is, gleaning is God's social security for the poor, for the orphans, and for the people who are alien, and the widows. And even, I'm going to read Leviticus 19 to see what exactly God's law was required for the farmers to do. Leviticus 19, verse 9 to 10. When you harvest your fields, do not cut the corn at the edges of the fields, and do not go back to cut the ears of corns that were left. Do not go back through your vineyard to gather the grapes that were missed, or to pick up the grapes that had fallen. Leave them for the poor and the foreigners. I am the Lord your God. So this is God's command to the farmers, to leave some for the poor. You see, it was a good, a godly program. It challenged the landowner to be generous to the poor. And it made the workers, the poor, to work for their food. But gleaning wasn't an easy task. It was a difficult task. Why? Because you have to work all day under the hot sun. And we had a test case a few weeks ago, a couple of weeks ago, when the temperatures reached 35, nearly 35. How it is difficult to stay in the sun in that heat. So working that heat for a whole day, it is not an easy thing to do. And more likely if you are a woman, and especially an alien, you are subject, you may be more likely to experience sexual harassment. So it's not a difficult task. Secondly, it was a humiliating task. And it was next to begging, you see. It's not a fun job that you wake up in the morning and say, oh, I'm going to drink today. It was humiliating. Because you depend on somebody else's favor. Somebody else allows you. Then you will be able to do it. Because especially in the time of judges, when everybody living their life as they saw fit. But the farmer, not all the farmer, probably would have practiced the law. So it would have been very difficult, humiliating. Farmer can turn away the poor. But Ruth, by God's grace, was granted the permission to glean, and her labor was fruitful. She was willing to carry out a menial, humiliating, a difficult task to support Naomi. And this was Ruth's labor of love for Naomi. And she was a perfect paraclesis, a model of perfect model of paraclesis. How do we respond when we were given, when we are given a task that seems below us? Because certain tasks, it takes humility to do it. I remember when I was new in Christ and I was invited to attend a house group to Paris. Our previous pastor's house. And I went to Serbia and I saw Barry, the pastor of this church, tidying up kitchen. challenged by that, because in the Asian community, you don't do this. It's your wife's work. She cooks and she tidy up the kitchen, and you just eat. It's very challenging. It was very challenging for me. Cleaning up the toilet, washing dishes, hoovering, emptying the dustbin, putting the bag that in the dustbin outside in the green bin. It's quite challenging, isn't it? And there's another kind of humility when you have to sit through the night with someone who's going through pain, through bereavement, through divorce. When this person is suffering, there's a humility in that. It takes humility. Pride person cannot come alongside others to do good. We should not sit back and watch people suffer, but we need to come alongside them and be there for them when they need us, praying, supporting, walking through the situation together. Bible says that love serves in humility. Jonathan, the only person I read in the Bible that loved David as he loved himself. And he was humble enough to let David be the next king. This is humility. In John 21, Jesus said to Peter, "Peter, do you love me 3 times? And Peter gave the same answer to the Lord Jesus. "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And 3 times, Lord Jesus said, "Serve me by feeding my disciple." So love serves in humility. As we can see, the Lord Jesus himself, Philippians 2, he humbled himself, became a servant, even obedient to the death upon the cross. And he said, "I have come not to be served, but to serve, and to give my life as a ransom for many." 1 John 3:16 says, summing up, "Lay down your life for your brothers as Jesus laid down his life for us." Love serves in humility. The first characteristics, love, Ruth's love for him. The second characteristics was kindness for Ruth. Chapter 2, verse 1 introduces us to Boaz. It says that Boaz was a rich and influential man. In other translation, NIV says a man of standing. And maybe other translation would say wealthy. Because the word is so broad in Hebrew, it's used actually for a noble wife in Proverbs 31. A woman of a noble character. So this man was everything that this word can mean. Noble, powerful, good and wealthy, influential and rich. Solid guy. And when he learned, obviously when he came from the city of Bethlehem, he learned about the woman that he saw, a new woman, working in his field, that she is a Moabitess who came back from Naomi. So instead of going and confronting her, mistreating her, or asking her to leave, he showed kindness to her. Now, kindness is another word which is quite a rich and powerful word in the Old Testament. And no single word in English captures its meaning. And it can mean kindness, love, mercy, loyalty, and compassion at the same time, or loving kindness. So Ruth was a vulnerable, a destitute young widow in need of love and care and support. And Boaz showed kindness to her in two ways. First, he provided her protection in verse 8 and 9. As we can see, Boaz called her my daughter. She did not call her name or a Moabitess woman, but my daughter. And then secondly, he advised her not to go to somebody else's fields, where she might be harassed or molested. He asked her to stay with his workers, lady workers, and work with them. And we can see that he invited her to stay with her workers, where she will be safe. And in verse 9, he told his men not to sexually harass her. And even later on, in the 15 and 16 verse, he said, don't embarrass her, don't say anything to her. So this is a protection. And he permitted her to drink, where this water is only for the workers of the landowner, not for gleaners, but he permitted her to drink from that water. So this is protection. Secondly, he generously provided for her in verses 14 to 16. Boaz invited Ruth to take a generous lunch with him. First bread and then roasted grain. Actually, if you see, he is serving her. Imagine she is sitting down in the shelter and he is coming up to serve her with some roasted grain. The Lord of the harvest serving the law of the law, the alien, a picture of Christ. He ordered his worker to let her glean even among the sheep. There might be more grain she would find. And then this is too much for the workers, his workers. He said, told them to even pull out some stalk out of the sheaves and leave her to pick up. I mean, I could imagine if you are working for a boss, you might be thinking, what happened to this guy? He's very generous to this lady. So what do you learn? What do we learn about the act of kindness and generosity of boss? The first thing is, let your life be shaped by the word of God, not the world. Let your life be shaped by the word of God, not the world. In the world, you will see the celebrities live a life. You will be like them, the best, if you follow them. But let the word of God, which will make you a kind person, gracious person, loving person, was character was shaped by the word of God. Notice in verse 4, he greeted his workers, saying, "The Lord be with you." For him, there was no difference between the life in the church and the life outside the church. He demonstrated the same godliness outside the church, even at work. Do we do that? Don't cut the corners when you support, when you help the poor, the widow, the orphans, and the aliens. We see here, this is what God in Deuteronomy 24 commanded his people to do. Don't cut the corners of the harvest of your field. 24, verse 19 onwards. It says, when you gather your crops and fail to bring in some of the corn and that you have cut, do not go back for it. It is to be left for the fathers, orphans, and the widows, so that the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. So this is the part of the law in the Old Testament, that you need to bless the poor. And James 1:27 says the similar things, that you need to bless the poor. This is the pure religion. I'm just going to read 1:27. It says, what God the Father considered to be pure and genuine religion is this: to take care of orphans and widows in their suffering and to keep oneself from being corrupted by the world. And we can see that in the book of Acts, first church, the first century church practiced this, continually helping the widow, the Grecian's widow, because they were not getting the food. So, be more generous than what law required. Boss is just pulling out the stalks from the sheaves and then leaving for her to pick up. Be more generous. Boss made Ruth, made sure that Ruth's labor could be richly rewarded. He made sure of that, that her time spent in her field is fruitful. In one day's labor, she earned over 2 weeks of grain worth of food. And it takes about 3 months, 2 to 3 months of harvesting barley, and then we, then in those 3 months, she could pick up food enough for a year, for two. So her labor was richly rewarded. Someone said that church exists for the benefit of the world. This is what our position is in the world, that to benefit others. Proverbs 19:17 simply put it like this, that whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done. No act of kindness is ever wasted. This is somebody said. No act of kindness is ever wasted. The golden rule, the Lord Jesus said that whatever you want others to do for you, do to others. If you be kind to others, you will receive kindness in return. And how was Boaz and Ruth were rewarded for their kindness? Boaz got a wife of a noble character. And Ruth received a godly and a rich husband. and their names were entered into the genealogy of the Lord Jesus Christ. What an honor. What a God. So let your life be shaped by the word of God. And secondly, develop a pastoral heart. Develop a pastoral heart. This is what Boaz, is doing with a pastoral heart. In verse 8, Boaz treated Ruth and Ilford like a family. He doesn't see her an outsider. He sees her family, my daughter. 11, verse 11, he appreciated Ruth's kindness to Naomi. You see, he has been told everything about Ruth, and he shared that. In verse 12, he desired, it's like a prayer, he desired that God will richly reward her, love her Ruth, and protect her under his wings in a special way. And little did he know that God will use him to protect and provide her. In verse 12, he accepted Ruth not as a slave, but as a new follower, new believer in Yahweh. You just have to see the Lord Jesus, the Yahweh. He said, your God will be my God. So, Boaz's heart reflected what God's heart is like. Does our heart, your heart, my heart reflect God's heart when it comes to welcoming the aliens or people from different backgrounds in our church, in our homes, at our work? Boaz welcomed Ruth into a community of God's people where she will grow and find refuge, hospitality, and kindness. And we can see that picture of a father who welcomed his prodigal son. We see that picture, that God's heart is like that. He welcomes sinners. Even Paul urged Philemon to welcome his runaway slave as a brother in the Lord. Sometimes new believers from different backgrounds find it difficult to integrate into the community of faith. I know a couple who came to this particular church. Don't come here. They don't come here anymore, so I won't name them either as well. The gentleman was born in a Christian community, Christian family, but the lady he married with from a different background. And then when I saw them and talked to them, she wanted to get baptized, but he became a hindrance. And he had a different understanding of the word of God. He said we have to be pure and everything in a way, everything right in every way, and then should be baptized. But that was the hindrance that kept him from being baptized for all his life. And the same understanding hindered her to integrate into the church. But eventually, obviously, we overcome that problem, and she was a part and moved into the community. You see, our immaturity can sometimes become the hindrance of other people to come into the church and take root. And I was obviously fortunate in that situation, in that sense, that I was given the perfect opportunity to grow in this family. So we need to show empathy and compassion practically understand the situation of the people and shield them from harm, as Boaz does to Ruth. Our faith and deeds must go together, as the book of James again reminds us. Says, what good is it, brothers, if you have faith but no deeds? So this was the first point, the characteristics of the Paraclesis: love and kindness. The second point, the effect of the characteristics. You see that Naomi was healed by the characteristics. That's the effect had on Naomi. Naomi was healed. You see, when in the last chapter, when she came from Moab, she was bitter because she was empty. Her name means pleasant, but she asked people to call her Mara, which is obviously bitter. And she lost her family, she lost her love for God, and she lost perspective on life, and lost all hope. The effect of her, this great tragedy she experienced affected her body and thinking. She looked older than her age, and she blames God for the death of his husband and two sons. And the whole tragedy actually left her bitter. She needs to experience healing in her life before she moves on. And God had already actually provided her the means through which he is going to heal her. What was those means? The first one is Naomi has Ruth. Naomi focused on what she lost, but did not focus on what she's got. You see, this is a common mistake. She has not returned totally empty, but she has Ruth. Ruth loves Naomi so much that she left everything, her family, the people, even God, and came to live with Naomi. A great sacrifice. Ruth immediately demonstrated that she is a capable, responsible, and loyal, and active woman. And she can accomplish a needed task, which was to provide food for the family. And the next two chapters will make it very clear that she is better than seven sons to Naomi. She gave birth to a son for Naomi, and God would bring healing to Naomi's bitterness through Ruth's love. Naomi doesn't see it all at this stage, but she will begin to see things that will heal her towards the end of our chapter this morning. So do we make the same mistake when our world is upside down, when we lose all hope? Do we become bitter, lose hope, and even blame God for everything that went wrong in our lives? Do we focus on what we have lost and what, not on what we've got? Focus on what God has not taken away from you. Focus on that. David Platt, this is a Christian pastor, after studying this book, he said something very profound. He said, when we feel God is far away, he might be laying a foundation to do something significant to show his faithfulness to us. I'll say it again. When God seems far away from us, he might be laying a foundation to do something significant to show his faithfulness to us. And we can see that in the life of Joseph as well as here in the life of Naomi. Joseph, when everything was going wrong in his life, his brothers are rejecting him, he sold him, and then Potiphar's wife against him, and then he was put into jail. Everything seems against her, but he did not know God is laying a foundation to do something big in his life to show his faithfulness to him. So don't undermine God's faithfulness to you. If you learn just one thing from this message, learn that God is faithful to you right now. And his faithfulness is forever. Secondly, Naomi has Boaz. He is introduced to us. He's like a Naomi's relative. And his generosity and protection towards Ruth had a healing effect. Naomi was stunned when she saw Ruth carrying a big load of barley and 10 kg. I mean, this is, 10 kg. Normally, when you go for gleaning, you probably pick up 1 or 2 or 3 pounds the most. But here, it's 10 kg, over 20 pounds. On the top of that, she experienced no harassment. And she gave the leftover lunch to Naomi. And the day was amazing success. The best news actually yet to be told. You see, in verse 19, Naomi asks Ruth, "Where have you been gleaning today?" And now Ruth, if you notice, knew where in whose field she was gleaning. But she does not know that Boaz is Naomi's relative. Neither, obviously, Boaz told her. But then again, Naomi knows Boaz is her relative, but she doesn't know that Ruth is gleaning in his fields. To build up the suspense, the author keeps Boaz's name till the end of the sentence. Let me read to you 19b. It says, So Ruth told Naomi that she had been working in a field belonging to a man named Boaz. Boaz! Look at Naomi's reaction to that. Generosity by Boaz produces a renewal of Naomi's faith. She began to experience healing from her bitterness. In verse 20, it says, "May the Lord bless Boaz," Naomi explained, "the Lord always keeps his promises to the living and the dead." And she went on, "That man is a close relative of ours, one of those responsible for taking care of us." You see, Naomi's prayer of blessing on Boaz was a turning point in her life. It lifted her out of the darkness and the despair into praise of God. Her spirit was healed by the kindness and the generosity and the compassion of Boaz. She discovered that God is with her. You see, they all came home to her. She learned when God seems even against her, even seems to be punishing her, He may be at the background, working at the background to bless her, to heal her. You may have not lost everything that Naomi has lost. But if you are feeling down or discouraged for some reason, know that God is faithful. He is there to bless and support in every situation. There is no situation is too difficult for Him that He cannot handle. All we need to do is to give that situation to Him and trust Him. And He will show you His faithfulness as He's shown His faithfulness. Normally, He shows His faithfulness through His people, through one another. And that's where we come in, Paraclesis. We need to come alongside each other to show love and kindness. It's our privilege. It's our privilege to be instruments of grace and love. So we like Ruth and Boaz in showing kindness to each other in practical ways. In the life of a believer, nothing happens by chance. And everything happens by God's appointment. In the story of Ruth, even in the time of Judges, very bad time, very dark time in the history of Israel, God is working in everyday life of His people. He's working through Ruth to show His love to Naomi, and He's working through Boaz to show His kindness to Ruth. And He is healing Naomi through their love and kindness, because He is faithful. He works through those who are open to Him. Are we open to Him this morning? Will you respond to His call to come alongside someone today? Let's pray together.